Victoria, as Indira was just discussing with Christina Hearn, is waking up to its sixth day in lockdown, but the latest COVID blip across the Tasman is the universal and the particular, right? Australia is one of a number of countries initially hailed for their response to the pandemic, but have seen a recent rise in cases in the last week. Taiwan, considered the gold standard for keeping COVID at bay, recorded more than 3,500 new cases a month ago. It was single figures. Health experts have admitted to complacency. I think we're seeing that here with our scanning, and have said they had placed their faith in border controls, which worked well until they didn't. Out of Taiwan's 23 million people, only 2% of the population have been vaccinated, and that's interesting too. Here, 500,000 doses have been given, nearly 200,000 of us are fully vaccinated. That equates to just under 4% of the population. So are we at risk until we get that rate higher? Senior lecturer in the University of Otago's Department of Microbiology and Immunology, Dr Jemma Geoghegan, and Dr Jemma Geoghegan specialises in researching emerging infectious diseases and the use of metagenomics to trace the evolution of viruses. I was just nervous about saying that, Dr. Geoghegan, because I don't even really understand what it means. We're so delighted to have you with us. Thank you. What are metagenomics?
Metagenomics, I guess it's a fancy way of saying sort of sequencing technologies that are able to unbiasedly sample things that, for example, in nature, and unbiasedly sample viruses and other things to see what's there before you even know what you're looking for. And that's exactly how the viruses caused that that COVID-19 was found, actually. So we didn't know what we were looking for. The researchers in China used metagenomic technology to discover it in the first place.
Okay, so we didn't know what we're looking for. Now we do, but the damn thing keeps mutating, right? So tell me how we get variants. Can you do a 101 for us on this? So how does a virus start in a certain form and then evolve?
Yeah, so when a virus enters your cells, it replicates, or it makes copies of itself. And when it does that, it makes mistakes. So when it's replicating its genetic code, it makes mistakes, and these mistakes are mutations. And it's not very good at correcting those mistakes. So those mistakes kind of get passed on to the next cell. And then eventually it gets passed on to the next person when it transmits to the next person. So these mistakes are mutations in the genetic code. And the vast majority of these mutations don't actually change the way the virus, you know, infects us or transmits between us. But sometimes a better mutation comes along, and that better mutation allows the virus to better adapt to infecting our cells more easily, or transmitting between us more easily, or it might change the way that it causes disease. So if it provides an advantage for the virus, then it's more likely to be passed on to the next infection, and then it will increase in frequency. And that's how you get these variants that are increasing in frequency around the world.
And we were just talking prior to you coming on with Christina Hearn, who was a reporter in Melbourne, talking about the variant there, which they're now calling the beast. These variants are, well, the ones that are successful and the ones that are taking are more transmissible and therefore more dangerous?
There's no evidence to suggest that the variant that's causing, or Kappa, which WHO have called this new variant that's causing the outbreak in Melbourne, is actually causing more severe disease. There's some early evidence to suggest that it might be more readily be able to infect cells, and therefore it's more contagious, a bit like the B117 variant that was first detected in the UK. So these, it's not surprising that these variants are emerging, because you know, the virus is becoming better at adapting to humans. So the more that it spreads between us, the more likely that these variants are going to arise.
It's interesting, isn't it? Because you described, that was a lovely word that you used, mistake. So the mistakes make the virus better at adapting to humans, therefore ensuring its survival. So they are remarkable things, viruses, aren't they? Even when they get it wrong, it sometimes improves them from a self-interested perspective of making sure they survive.
Yeah, I guess all life evolves, right? But viruses are kind of the best exemplars of evolution by natural selection, because you can, their evolutionary processes are so rapid that you can see it in real time. So you can see these evolving As this outbreak is occurring over the last 18 months, we've seen this virus change dramatically and adapt to humans. But all life is evolving. It's just viruses are doing it really quickly.
Yeah, it's fascinating to watch. Okay, where are we heading? And I, look, we were having a conversation in the air break, and you said, you know, your two cents worth is as good as anyone else's. Well, that's very modest of you. Your two cents worth is way better than mine. So where, and Indira, actually, it was Melissa was talking about the WHO saying the worst may be yet to come. Do you have a sense of where we're heading with COVID?
Well, on the one hand, I agree that I don't think that we're even halfway through this pandemic. I think we've got a few more years left of it. But on the other hand, where countries have done a huge, vaccine, a really successful vaccine rollout, and numbers are dropping. And, you know, the UK didn't have any deaths yesterday, the first time in over a year. And I think that's a huge achievement. And it goes to show that the vaccines are effective. We do need to make sure people get vaccinated, and just, you know, not just us, but everyone around the world needs to be vaccinated and ensure that those vaccines are going to be effective and mean stopping the spread of the virus.
And this is where the traditional inequalities amplify, right? So some countries are better equipped to get the vaccines to their population than others. Some countries haven't even got the vaccines. So they are the countries most at risk, clearly. And that means that in numerical terms, we may see more cases in year two than we saw in year one?
Yeah, I mean, I guess it's really hard to say what's going to happen. I think what we do need is a global effort in vaccination rather than a national effort, because, you know, it's all very well if we vaccinate our population, but if the virus is left to spread uncontrolled in other places, it's more likely to change and evolve new variants. And these new variants might be able to escape the effectiveness of the vaccine. So it's going to render our vaccine not very good. So we need a global effort in this. And I think the WHO have been saying this for a long time.
I know that your job is not to be stern with us, but can I ask you a favour? Because I think we need somebody to be stern with us. And there is a sense, particularly from Taiwan, where they're being quite explicit about this, that complacency has let them down. Do you sense that complacency makes us vulnerable here?
Oh, for sure. I think we do forget, you know, what it's like to be going through an outbreak. I think apart from Auckland, the rest of the country has really had relative freedom, to be honest. And it's really easy to forget. And, you know, we don't know what it's like to sort of live with this virus on a day-to-day basis. So I think complacency really is a dangerous thing that we need to overcome.
Dr. Jemma Geoghegan, we so appreciate when you come on Breakfast. Boy, you make the complex and the inexplicable understandable, and we're very grateful for your time every time you join us. Thank you so much.
Thanks, John.